Hello students, welcome to Alice Color Classes. So today I will be taking the fourth part of chapter 13, that is why do we fall ill. Okay, so if you will go in part 1, part 2 and part 3 video, we have discussed laws about disease, how it is caused, what are the pathogenic agents that are causing different kinds of disease. Okay, so today we shall be discussing about communicable disease. It is also called as transmissible disease. Okay. Then we will see how pathogenic gets transferred. In the part 3 of the video, you can see that we have discussed about all kinds of pathogens. And here we will see how pathogens get transferred. Okay? Next, we will see the characteristic of infectious agent. Different infectious agents are there. Different pathogens are there. What are their characteristics? How do they multiply in our body? All these we are going to see. Then we are going to see pictures of different microorganisms. Okay, different microorganisms we will see, like SARS virus we are going to see, Trypanosoma we will see, Staphylococcus bacteria, adult roundworm and Leishmania. Okay, so these are some of the microorganisms or pathogens we are going to discuss. In the last, we will see penicillin, how it helps us to fight against bacteria. Okay? So these are the topics that we are going to discuss today. We shall start with communicable disease. So firstly, we shall start with communicable disease. Okay? As the name itself suggests, communicable means communicated. Communicated. Okay? Communicated, you are getting from what we do. Communicated is to be transferred from one person to the other. It can be communicated. Okay, communication. Excuse me. So communicable disease are also known as infectious disease. Okay, and also called as transmissible disease. Okay, because it is being transmitted, it is being communicated. So this is called as infectious disease and transmissible disease. Okay? Also called as infectious. Okay? Also called as infectious disease. Infectious disease and transmissible. Okay, since it is being transmitted, transmissible disease. Fine. So these are three names. You can say either communicable disease, or you can say infectious disease, or you can say a transmissible disease. Fine. So this infectious disease is spread from infected person. Suppose somebody is infected with some kind of disease. Okay, so from that infected person, it is being transmitted to someone else in a variety of ways. Okay, so that way can be any in which it is being transmitted. Okay, so an infected person is here. Suppose this person is infected. Okay. So he can transfer the particular disease to someone else. Okay? Anybody he can transfer. In a variety of ways. Okay? He can transfer it in a variety of ways. Such a disease is called as communicable disease. Okay? So if the definition is being asked, you have to say that the infectious disease which is being transferred from the infected person to to someone else. Okay, in a several ways, in variety of ways, or you can say in several ways, is called fine. So this is a communicable disease, also called as infectious disease and or transmitted disease. The infectious disease which is being transferred from infected person. Somebody is infected, he is going to transfer it to somebody else. In several ways he can transfer it, and that is going to be called as communicable disease. Okay, so this type of disease is communicated from one person to the animal. Okay, this type of disease is being communicated from one person to another. Okay, next what happens, as if you will refer my part 3 of the video, we have discussed there that we have seen that lots of pathogens are there, like viruses, bacteria, or protozoans are there, fungi is there, or even the worms are there. So these pathogens, they cause communicable disease. Okay, so this communicable disease is caused by several pathogens like bacteria is there, virus is there, fungi, protozoa, and worms. Okay, so these are the pathogens that transmit communicable disease from one person to another person. Okay, so what happens? A person may develop a communicable disease after being infected by the pathogen. Okay, somebody, some normal person who is not having any kind of disease is being infected by the pathogens. Once the pathogen enters in the body, he is being infected by such and such disease. Okay, so once the pathogen that enters in the body, it becomes replicated. Okay, it starts to replicate, and the individual may begin to experience the symptoms. Okay, so what happens if suppose some normal person is there and a pathogen enters in its body? So what happens when pathogen is entering in the body? This pathogen, it starts replicating. Okay, it starts replicating, and what happens is this normal person now is going to have experiencing some symptoms which is of a particular disease. Okay, so about communicable disease, we have seen that it is also called infectious disease or transmissible disease. If the infectious disease is being transferred from infected person to someone else in several ways, we will see that that is the main discussion of today, that how it can be transmitted. Okay, so this type of disease is being communicated from one person to another person. It is caused by several pathogens. Okay, this question is sometimes asked in a 1 mark question, that how this communicable disease is being transferred. So it is being transferred by pathogens like bacteria, viruses, fungi, protozoans, and all. And normal person is there, and a pathogen is going to enter in his body. As soon as the pathogen enters in the body, they start replicating in the body, and the person is now going to have some symptoms, some signs that he is being infected. Okay, so this was about some introduction, some definition about communicable disease. Okay. So now we are going to see how pathogens can be transferred. As we have seen that these pathogens enters in a body and they starts replicating, thus the symptoms starts of a particular disease. Now the question is कि how these pathogens can be transferred? कैसे वो pathogen किसी human body में आते हैं actually? Okay, so there are several five basic reasons you can see how these pathogens they can enter in our body. The first thing is that if there is a direct contact with a person that is carrying the pathogen, okay? If you directly contact with that person, how you can directly contact with that person? Suppose a particular person is being infected by a pathogen, he comes to meet you, you shake your hand. So shaking hand is hand-to-hand touch, a direct contact is there, okay? Excuse me. So a direct contact is there. So this direct contact is of shaking hand will cause the pathogen to enter in the other person's body also. Next, what happens? Suppose there is a contaminated fluid, okay? Such as a blood is there, a person who is being infected, whose that blood is also being infected, his mucus is there, his saliva is there. So anyhow that blood of that infected person is being transmitted to a normal person. The saliva of that person in any form, in any way goes to a normal person. Okay, then third thing comes the inhaling contaminated droplets. Okay, if you inhale the contaminated droplets from another person, suppose somebody is coughing. So the pathogen is coming out and the person is standing in front inhales it. Or somebody sneezes like this and the person is standing in the front, he inhales the droplets. So that is also a way in which the pathogen can be transferred. Fourth way is that if you receive a bite from any animal or any other insect that is carrying that disease, okay? Suppose a mosquito is there, a mosquito is carrying some particular disease and he bites you. So obviously you are going also to suffer with that pathogen, okay? And the last fifth one is that if you take some contaminated water or food, okay? So these are five ways in which the pathogens can be transferred from an infected person to a normal person, or the pathogens can enter into the body of a normal person. So how the pathogens can be transferred, or you can say can enter into the body of a normal person, okay, into the body of a normal person. So there are five different ways. The first one is a direct contact with a person. Direct contact with a person carrying pathogen. Okay? Direct contact with a person carrying pathogen. So that can be, example is like shaking hands. Okay, the second one is when we come in contact with contaminated fluid, okay? Contact with contaminated fluid. That contaminated fluid can be anything. Like blood is there, saliva is there, or mucus is there. Okay? So, I would like to tell you one thing, students, that normally what happens, sometimes it is being there that you must have heard that some person was not having any disease, but he was being transmitted by a blood. Okay, so what happens sometimes, some person goes in a blood bank, he is in a need of a blood and he takes that blood, or unknowingly
he is not knowing that blood is of a person who is being suffering from some kind of disease. And when that blood is being entered in the body of a person who is normal, who is not infected, that disease is going to be transferred. Okay? तो ऐसा बहुत केसेस हुए हैं कि जिसमें ब्लड ट्रांसफर के थ्रू किसी को, जिसको कोई नॉर्मल पर्सन को कोई डिजीज नहीं थी बट हो जाती है, क्योंकि वो ब्लड ही कंटामिनेटेड था, उस ब्लड में ही कोई वो पर्टिकुलर डिजीज के पैथोजेंस थे. ओके, सो द थर्ड इज द इनहेलिंग कंटामिनेटेड ड्रॉपलेट्स.
Very good precise PDF notes are there.
and also the MCQ questions are there, which is going to benefit you a lot. Okay, you can check where you start. And if you are interested for live classes also, please contact us through our email ID or through our phone number, which is mentioned in the description box. So thank you, students. If you are not subscribed yet, I am thanking you in the advance that you are going to subscribe it surely. Okay, so this was the points of how pathogens can be transferred. Now we will see that communicable diseases are being divided into four main categories. That is an airborne disease. It can be a sexual contact. It can be, or it can be due to some animal can spread it, or it can be due to contaminated water and food. So these diseases we will be seeing one by one carefully. So we have seen that how pathogens are being transferred. So now the question is, if these pathogens are being transferred, there is a need to understand the characteristic of these infectious agents. Okay, so we should understand these infectious agents or these pathogens very nicely. So for that, what we should do, the question is, why do we need to understand the characteristic of these infectious agents or pathogens? Okay, so why there is a need to understand the characteristic of these infectious agents or pathogens? Okay, so we have already seen that how these pathogens, they are being transmitted, and now we should understand the characteristic. That if we will be understanding these characteristics, we can treat the disease caused by them in a better way. Okay, if we are going to understand the characteristic of these pathogens, we can treat the disease very efficiently. Okay, so we can find out which medicine would work on which infectious agent. Okay, what is the infectious agent and which medicine is going to be worked on it. So some characteristics of infectious agents we shall be discussing. Okay, so if suppose there is a pathogen or a infectious agent caused by them, then what we need to know? We need to know the medicine. Medicine for that disease. Okay, so this is a flow. First the pathogen should be known, then the disease that is being caused by that pathogen, and then the medicine for that particular disease. So for that we should know the characteristic of these infectious agents or pathogens. So the first very thing we know, that viruses live inside the host body. If we are the host, these viruses, they are going to live inside our body. The second thing is that bacteria do not generally live inside the host body. Bacteria do not live inside our host body. Generally it happens, rarely the case that when it is going to live. But viruses lives in our body. Now these bacteria, viruses and even the fungi, they multiply quickly. Means they start replications. Okay, they multiply, they replicate. Okay, but these worms, they do not multiply quickly. Okay, so we have seen the category of all these four: viruses, bacteria and the fungi and the worms. So how they are behaving? So first thing is that viruses, they live inside our body. Lives inside the host body. Okay, but bacteria do not generally live inside the host body.
Bacteria
generally do not live in host body. Okay, now what happens? These bacteria, viruses and fungi, they multiply. Virus, bacteria and fungi, they replicate. Okay, but the worms as a pathogen, they do not replicate quickly. Worms don't multiply quickly. Okay, so some of the characteristics are that viruses live inside the host body. Bacteria generally do not live inside the host body. Virus, bacteria and fungi, they replicate, means they multiply, but worms, they do not replicate quickly. Okay, so this was some of the features which makes us understanding about these infectious agents, or you can say we can have a deeper understanding of the different pathogens. Now I will be showing you the picture of different microorganisms. Okay, some microorganisms we are going to deal with. So these SARS viruses, here you can see, they are coming out of these infected cells. Okay, so it is a infected cell, and these SARS viruses, they are trying to come out of these infected cells. Fine. So now what happens? If 500 nanometer is around, it is very small in size. You can say it's about 500 nanometer. Okay, this size is. Size is around this. Okay, so these are the viruses, very small in size, and they are trying to come out of these cells. Okay, this cell is an infected cell and they are trying to come out of it. So after SARS virus, we will be seeing Trypanosoma. Okay, so this Trypanosoma is a protozoan organism. It is a protozoan organism. You can see it is somewhat, the shape is like this. Okay, they are just curved like this. Okay, so it is a basically a protozoan right? And
here I am making a red blood cell. This oval shape.
So, trypanosoma is a protozoan organism. So, this is being this protozoa, it causes sleeping sickness. What it causes? It causes sleeping sickness. So, if you will refer in my part 3 video, you will see that there we have discussed the different diseases that are being caused by different kinds of organisms. Okay, so we have discussed about sleeping sickness also there, okay, how it is being caused by protozoans. And today in part 4, we are discussing the picture of different microorganisms. Some microorganisms we are going to discuss. So you can see here, this is the structure same substance. This is lying next to the protozoa and it is the red blood cell. It is the red blood cell, that is the RBC, and this is a protozoa. Okay, so this protozoa is basically for causing sleeping sickness. Okay, trypanosoma. Fine. So next we will be discussing about a bacteria. We have discussed a virus, a protozoa. Now we will see a bacteria, that is a Staphylococcus bacteria. Okay, Staphylococcus bacteria. In NCERT also these microorganisms are being explained, so you should see these very carefully. Okay, coccus or in cocci, you can see coccus bacteria. Staphylococcus bacteria. So now if we talk about these bacteria, they are very like this, shapes are there. Okay, and they are very spongy types bacteria they are, and what they causes acne. Acne disease is being caused by them.
So they are found in small intestine. Okay. Against bacteria, and everybody should be aware of penicillin. It was the first antibiotic
helps to fight against bacteria.
Present since birth.
So what happens? This disease is being acquired by our time. Okay? बाद में time के साथ ये disease acquire कर ली गई. It is not acquired. This disease is not present since birth. Not present since birth. Acquired by time. Okay, it has been acquired by a person after birth. Okay, so what happens? Suppose based on the ability from one individual to other individual, sometimes it spread. Okay, some person acquired some disease by some other person. And sometimes what happens, if proper vaccination, immunization is not done, a person can suffer some kind of disease after their birth also. Like polio. Polio is what? If you are not being vaccinated with polio vaccine, you will be suffering from polio. But polio is not a disease that is by birth. Okay, it is acquired after birth. Okay, so example is polio. If a child is born, he is fit and fine, he has not got polio. But if that child is not given the polio vaccine timely, what is going to happen? If he is not given the vaccine timely, he is going to acquire a disease, and that is a polio disease, and that disease is going to be carried out through him lifelong. Okay, so this was, we have seen how, what is the difference between congenital disease and an acquired disease. Okay, so this one is present since birth, but this is an acquired disease, is not present since birth. They are acquired by a person after birth. So here is the example, is the hole in the heart of an infant, and the example is a polio. If a person is suffering from polio, it is being acquired afterward. Okay, so this was all for today. Here I complete my part 4, and we have seen lots of things in this. I hope you like my video. If you like my video, please give a like button. And if you have not subscribed our channel on this scholar yet, please do subscribe it so that you can get the notification of the videos when we are uploading it. Also, in the description box, you can check, there is a link of our app. There you can go download the app from the Play Store, and you are going to find very interesting videos there, very good precise PDF notes and MCQ questions, which is going to help you to examine yourself. And also, if you are interested for live classes, you can mail or contact us through our phone number, which is given in the description box. So thank you so much. Thank you for watching my video. Please give a like button.